This program contains spoilers for Wandavision, but don't touch that dial. This episode's really fun.
WandaVision is a lot. It's a high-concept superhero show. It's an homage to Dick Van Dyke-era sitcoms. It's a story about processing grief and loss. It's all about magic and sorcery. It's a meta-commentary on the format of sitcom television. It's a quirky sci-fi show about a group of agents. It's a big bucket of red herrings. It's a sloppy mess, and it is most certainly WandaVision. But is it a good show? Yes. No. Sometimes. Period. Exclamation point. Question mark. In that order.
See, the general consensus with WandaVision is that it's a really fun and unique story. The best thing Marvel has ever done with the MCU. But somewhere around the halfway mark, the show starts to lose its luster. It's due to a lot of factors, but most people seem to agree that the first half of the show is superior to the latter. But to take a page from Marvel's own book, what if it didn't have to be like that? What if I were somehow in the writer's room for WandaVision and I was able to change a few things around just to make the show a little bit better? Now, I'm not saying I'm a better writer than Jack Schaefer or any of the other people who worked on WandaVision. Heck no, I can't even write a college essay without 10 errors per paragraph. Apparently can't even write a script right because I've already messed up half of the words. But what I am saying is that with just a few small changes, WandaVision can truly be the Emmy-nominated show it wants to be.
My first goal in mind is to make the tone of the show feel more consistent. One of the reasons the first few episodes of WandaVision work so well is because of the mystery of the unknown and the suspense felt throughout these episodes. I love that the show basically starts off with giving you absolutely no information. It starts with the fake show of WandaVision and you have no idea what's going on. You don't know why Wanda or Vision is enacting this black and white sitcom.
Vision, in fact, is the bigger question because the last time we saw this character, he was given the most violent death in the MCU. How is this character here?
There's also this overwhelming sense of dread, like we're watching something horrible happen, but we can't exactly explain it. And we'll later find out that we are right in this assumption because Wanda is controlling the townsfolk through her anguish.
The tension is held up very well in the first three episodes, but then in episode four, we get a peek behind the curtain and we get to see what's happening outside of Westview. That's when the problems start happening. The tension built before this reveal is now gone, and now that we keep switching between WandaVision and the real world, our focus is suddenly shifting all the time, and it's lessening the impact of the reveals within WandaVision. So here's my first change. Episode 4, We Interrupt This Program, is moved out of its current slot and then placed right behind the Halloween episode.
In addition, I think that all the scenes from outside Westview should be moved into that episode as well, except the part in the Halloween episode where Vision leaves the Hex and starts disintegrating. I think this keeps the mystery elements intact that made the first few episodes so special, and it makes for a more fun reveal of what's been going on outside of Westview after this moment. So then we get an extra long episode that takes a step back and shows us what's been happening on the outside.
The second thing I want to change is just emphasizing that Wanda is doing very bad things for very selfish reasons.
Yes, the Hex was created out of her grief and she had no intention of keeping the townsfolk prisoner, but she chooses not to let them have any free will or allow them to leave Westview, so this does show a more villainous side to Wanda. There's this moment in the Halloween episode where Herb asks Wanda if she wants anything changed, and I don't think that fits in really well with the narrative so far. The only time the residents of Westview should acknowledge the false reality that they're in is at the end when Agnes breaks Wanda's control over them. That worked pretty well, I think.
Also, this is just a side thing, but why wasn't anything done with the beekeeper character from episode 2? We know he's actually a S.W.O.R.D. agent, but after Wanda does the rewind trick, we never see or hear anything from this character ever again, and that's just frustrating.
I propose that in the Outside of Westview episode I made up, we get a good look at this guy's face, and then when you go back to episodes 3 through 5, you can see him in the background of some scenes. Wanda has officially made him part of the show.
I feel like Wanda is currently in a state where she is always aware of her boundaries, so if this beekeeper is just shoved off into the background. She's not going to worry about him at all, unlike Monica, who directly asks about Ultron, so she throws Monica out of Westview. Another problem solved.
I also think that the Vision should have a slightly different origin in this version. After Monica gets thrown out of Westview, Wanda has this minor hallucination where she sees Vision as he was after his death, which at the time led to the very popular fan theory that Wanda had actually stolen the corpse of Vision and was controlling it like a puppet. It was the darkest, strangest, most out there concept the show had thrown at us so far, and it was awesome. But as it turned out, Wanda didn't break in and steal the Vision. She really just wanted to see him one last time and give him a proper burial. Hayward's been lying this whole time, and they used the energy from Wanda's magic to bring their rebuilt Vision online.
That's not as fun as metal puppet Vision, so I think this needs a wee bit of a change. Now, as cool as Wanda stealing Vision would be, that's probably a step too far if we want to keep Wanda a redeemable character. So here's my new pitch.
In the flashback, Wanda breaks the window and goes down to Vision. She tries to connect, but she can't feel him and begins to cry. Before she leaves, she'll move her eyes across his corpse and find a small sci-fi looking ball. It'll look really weird, have a bunch of wires connected to it, but for all intents and purposes, this is the Vision's heart.
I'm pulling this out of my nether regions, please bear with me.
Wanda uses her magic to disconnect the wires, which leads the scientist to try and stop her, and then she screams please, which will lead them to back off. She takes the heart and leaves, with Hayward looking shocked. Cut to the scene where Wanda goes to what would have been her forever home with Vision. She cries and then accidentally casts the spell that creates the hex. At the same time, she's clutching onto Vision's heart, which, being blasted with all this energy, creates the Hex Vision that now exists in the show.
You might be thinking, well, this is all well and good, but now what do you do with the heart?
I think the heart can make appearances in some of the previous episodes as a weird background prop. Maybe Mr. Heart can point it out and Vision could be like, oh, that's just a Sokovian good luck charm. That was the worst Vision voice I've ever heard in my life. Later in the Halloween episode, Vision is about to go out and investigate Westview behind Wanda's back. Pietro offers to cover as the boy's father figure for the night, and Wanda agrees to the terms. Before Vision leaves, Pietro hypes up the boys and starts causing problems as he plays catch with himself at super speed with the heart. Vision takes it from him, says it's not a toy, and he decides he's gonna take it with him. Why not? Later in the episode, Vision tries to leave the hex. Hayward and his goons are watching this unfold. Vision falls to his knees, begs for their help, and ends up dropping the heart on the ground. Hayward shouts, grab that, and his goons grab the heart right before the hex begins to expand.
So that's how we ghost Vision online. Not through some random object that we suddenly have, but through the final piece that Ghost Vision needs in order to come online. I hope most of this has made sense so far, because I'm about to run into my biggest hurdle. Humanizing Hayward.
Doing dishes, because video games are as fun as dishes. Watch home screen.
Hey, while I have you here, can we agree that the commercials in WandaVision are like super weird? I mean, yeah, they're funny snippets that look into Wanda's psyche, but if she's seen all these old sitcoms on VHS, then how does she know what the commercial style was for each era? She probably doesn't have fond memories of seeing ads for expensive watches or toasters. But that's enough of a sidetrack. These commercials slap. Personal favorite one has to be the claymation one. It's fun, horrifying, and very open to interpretation. Now, go back to the episode now.
And now, on with the show.
Hayward, without a doubt, is the worst villain in the MCU. I honestly don't understand what they were thinking when they came to writing this guy. The Hayward we first meet at the sword building is a completely different character from the Hayward we see for the rest of the series. He just becomes a very unlikable character for no good reason. But it really doesn't need to be this way, because in the future we're going to want to understand the proper structure of sword. Sure, Nick Fury is probably in charge, but he's off in space, so there's a bit of a disconnect. If we make Hayward a more understandable character, we can learn to tolerate him at least, and welcome him in future appearances. So big change, Hayward is just the guy in charge who has realized that Wanda currently is in possession of the one thing that can bring the only synthesoid on the planet online. Maybe have a foundation for a reassembled Avengers team too. Why not? How exactly would this new Hayward play out?
I can see a few different ways this can change the show.
In the episode where we focus on the characters outside of the Hex, we'll see that Hayward at first wants to peacefully resolve the situation with Wanda. Now with Monica out of the Hex, Hayward in a meeting with the team concludes that it is not only possible for things to go into the Hex, but is also possible to bring them out. And, since this is my version of the show, he wants to try and recover the Beekeeper agent who is currently mind-controlled in the Hex. Monica and her team conclude that they can maintain control of an object if it originates from the era WandaVision is currently in. They heavily modify an old 80s era car, which they can probably get pretty quickly since there's apparently an old car dealership down the road from them, and they drive it in to spy on the neighborhood and look for the agent. Wanda spots this while she and the boys are looking for Sparky the dog, she throws it out of the Hex, and we have a similar scene play out where Wanda turns the soldiers on Hayward. Now with this moment, he's upset for a logical reason, and he really wants to get his vision online to try and stop Wanda. He doesn't send Monica and her team away, but he does sideline them. They make a plan to go get another vehicle into the Hex, Monica and Jimmy get away, boom, back where we are.
This new version of Hayward also wouldn't try to shoot children. Oh yeah, remember when he pulled a gun on Tommy and Billy and didn't even hesitate to shoot? New Hayward wouldn't do that.
In this version, when Wanda starts to rip apart the Hex, he and the Sword Vans go into the Hex to try and get as many civilians out as possible. This will be the perfect opportunity for this, since Wanda will be distracted by both Agatha and Ghost Vision. With that, our Hayward is a decent fellow with a bit of a chip on his shoulder, but we like him enough and he can show up in future projects.
Speaking of characters that suddenly don't work, let's talk about the... And am I even allowed to say this on air? The boner in the room.
Boner.
The Quicksilver reveal in the show was the perfect bomb to drop at the end of the 80s episode. But it's not the Quicksilver that we know. It's the Quicksilver from the X-Men movies, a series completely disconnected from the MCU until this moment. But then later in the season, it turns out it's not him. It's just some guy named Ralph Boner.
Boner.
It's a reveal that gives you whiplash. It makes you wonder, why couldn't it have just been the Fox Quicksilver? Thematically, it still makes sense since his appearance is a commentary on sitcoms recasting characters without the audience noticing. And technically, timeline-wise, this show takes place after Loki, which at the end of season one of Loki, the multiverse was unleashed, so it is possible. So why can't it be that Wanda's emotions were so powerful she accidentally ripped into the X-Men universe and stole their Quicksilver?
Also, this is just a side note. At the end of the new Venom movie, something like this actually does happen, so I feel like I am vindicated in my choice here.
I got a couple scenarios in mind with this version of the story. First is when Agatha is interrogating Wanda in the murder basement. Agatha talks about how she was trying to get Wanda to break with Pietro, or Fietro if you want. Wanda says that was you, and now Agatha says, well, technically, sweetie, that was you. I'm being totally honest here, I have no idea who that guy is, but there was just something about him that seemed different. I took it as the perfect opportunity, and you fell for it! Second scenario is in the finale. We're in the attic where Monica and Pietro are. Monica is being held prisoner by Pietro, and she uses her new energy powers to take him down. She notices the necklace and yanks it off, freeing Pietro from the spell. He says, whoa, whoa, easy, what's going on here? Monica snarkingly snips back, well, why don't you tell me, Pietro? Camera turns to Quicksilver, he looks confused. Pietro? What are you talking about? My name's Peter.
Boom! X-Men Quicksilver is now in the MCU.
From this point, Monica and Peter go grab the kids, maybe he puts on the silly Halloween costume, and the four of them go to help the Westview residents escape. I see nothing wrong with having a new Quicksilver. We're due for a new character with their own unique power set.
So now that we've gotten two of the problem characters out of the way, let's knock out the third one as well. Agatha. She works conceptually, but in practice, she's a very confusing character.
We get a whole number about how she's been behind everything, but at this point, the only openly bad thing that she has caused was the death of Sparky. I realize this definitely justifies the song number and degenerates like her belong on a cross, but it acts like she was responsible for the torture and the Hex. But she isn't. Wanda is. Agatha isn't playing the role of the meddling neighbor, she's the nosy neighbor. She's getting all in the business of the Vision household, but she isn't openly committing evil acts. With that, I want to change Agatha around a little bit. In this new version, Agatha has been living in Westview for many, many years. She's several hundred years old, it's fine. Let's say she got snapped and came back, and now feels the need to start practicing her witch magics again. All of a sudden, Wanda creates the Hex and changes Westview, but Agatha somehow isn't affected. Maybe it's because of how powerful she is. Curious about the new witch who has seemingly set up shop on her turf, she spends as much time as she can trying to get all up in Wanda's business. When she realizes that Wanda is horribly untrained, she lures her into her creepy basement and starts asking how she is able to cast such powerful spells. I also think Agatha should have a different goal than the one she currently has in the show. Her current goal is fine enough. She wants to take Wanda's power for herself and become an all-powerful witch. It's okay, but I think her plan should be a bit more intricate than that. She probably realizes that Wanda is dangerous. She was the woman who almost soloed the Mad Titan, for God's sakes. So instead of trying to get the energy directly from Wanda, Agatha is going to use Billy and Tommy as batteries. Wanda will figure this out in the finale, demand that she release them due to her emotional attachment, and Agatha, who is devoid of this empathy, attempts to justify these actions by telling Wanda, "You can probably make more."
I think Agatha going for the kids is thematically better than going straight for Wanda, because in episode 2, there's this constant motif of for the children. Like, someone definitely wants Wanda and Vision to use the Build-A-Baby kit from Robots.
But it's okay. Making the baby's the fun part.
So maybe in episode 2, after Wanda finds the helicopter, Agatha, during their conversation, probes about Wanda and Vision's relationship in the bedroom. This'll work a little bit better. Okay, one last change, and you're gonna have to stick with me for this one. I don't like how they use the title of Scarlet Witch in this show. And it's not because the line was delivered horribly.
Scarlet Witch.
That's awful!
Somehow in the MCU, 6 years after her introduction, this is the first time anyone has referred to Wanda as the Scarlet Witch. And it kind of falls flat because we already know that's her superhero name. It's been like that for ages. But then again, the MCU typically has superheroes on a first name basis. Tony, Steve, Natasha, Bruce, T'Challa, you get it. So it's kind of weird to just out of nowhere have Agatha declare that Wanda is this super important magical figure.
Which, speaking of that, this moment also brings forward one of my biggest writing pet peeves, prophecies. I very much dislike prophecy stories. It takes the relatability and the agency away from a character, and it essentially tells the audience what's going to happen. Example, in Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix, we are introduced to the Room of Prophecies in the Ministry of Magic, which is already just setting off like 400 alarms in my head. We specifically hear one prophecy, and it reads as follows.
The one with the power to vanquish the Dark Lord approaches. Born to those who have thrice defied him. Born as the seventh month dies, and the Dark Lord will mark him as his equal. But he will have power the Dark Lord knows not, and either must die at the hand of the other, for neither can live while the other survives.
This prophecy is either in reference to Harry or Neville, depending on how you like to interpret it, but I feel this prophecy diminishes the relatability of Harry as a character. Before this, he was just a random child of powerful wizard parents who were murdered by an evil wizard, but the love of his mother was so strong that Voldemort couldn't hurt him. Now with this prophecy, it turns out it was Harry's destiny to destroy Voldemort, and that just makes me so upset.
Another example, you know what one of the worst things about The Amazing Spider-Man is? Besides, you know, everything. It's that whole subplot about Peter's parents and how they were actually the ones to create the spider that gave Peter his superpowers. This diminishes the entire concept of Spider-Man, where any kid could have been bitten by the spider, but it just so happened to be Peter, and now he has to deal with the responsibility of his great power. It's stuff like this that hurts Wanda as a character, because she's no longer special. She's just some prophesized entity that may or may not have appeared on Earth before.
So that's why I don't like this moment. So we're gonna cut it out. Wanda's powered by chaos magic, so that's gonna be our explanation for why she's so powerful. It probably works similarly to Dr. Malcolm's chaos theory. The magic could easily fester in one direction, but a second time it could easily go another way. Wanda just so happens to have access to chaos magic. It started when she was a child in Sokovia, it was amplified by the Mind Stone, and now Wanda is let loose with the Darkhold to learn about how to properly use her magic. And if we really want to have a moment where the Scarlet Witch name is dropped in the show, we can add it in the Outside Westview episode. Hayward asks Jimmy Woo if Wanda has a codename like the rest of the Avengers, and Jim can say, "Well, some people at the Bureau considered Scarlet Witch, but we haven't been able to confirm whether Miss Maximoff is actually in possession of magical abilities." And Hayward can just look over at the hex and say, "Looks pretty magical to me."
And there we are, a slightly altered version of WandaVision that more or less leads to the same outcome, but in a more satisfying manner. At least, in my opinion, anyway. Look, I'm not a serialized television writer. I'm just doing this to get groceries. Last thoughts? Doctor Strange should have shown up in one of the commercials. Darcy should have less annoying dialogue.
The rabbit is Mephisto. Halloween episode next time. Bye!